People in newsrooms and at water coolers across the country were abuzz today with word that the flagship paper in the nation's capital is about to be sold to an internet pioneer.
It was very surprising. No, nobody knew it was for sale.
Washington residents and the newspaper industry were still reeling today over news about the news that Amazon founder Jeff Bezos is buying the Washington Post. Publisher Catherine Weymouth, part of the family that owns the paper, said Bezos will pay $250 million for the Post and its smaller publications. Today, she explained the decision to a Washington Post interviewer.
This is a transition to a good owner who has a lot he could bring to us, and that we were not on the auction block and just, you know, auction to the highest bidder.
The purchase will end nearly eight decades of ownership by the Graham family. Patriarch Eugene Meyer bought the Post at auction in 1933. His daughter, Catherine Graham, led the paper as it rose to national prominence beginning in the 1970s. First, with its coverage of the Pentagon Papers under executive editor Ben Bradley, and then Watergate and Bob Woodward and Carl Bernstein's Pulitzer Prize-winning reporting that brought down President Richard Nixon.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
Her son, Donald Graham, followed in her footsteps. Subscriptions peaked in 1993 at more than 800,000. But like many other papers, the Post has faced declining circulation and ad revenue in the digital age.
I've been a subscriber before, but I don't really subscribe to anything anymore. I read everything online.
Enter digital giant Bezos. Former executive editor Leonard Downey says the bet is that the online shopping pioneer can ensure the Post's survival.
Jeff Bezos understands this new world that we're in, and that all news organizations have to adapt to, whether it's Channel 7 or the Washington Post.
The Post is hardly alone in seeking buyers with deep pockets. Over the weekend, Newsweek magazine was sold to IBT Media, the publisher of International Business Times. Red Sox owner John Henry bought the Boston Globe from the New York Times Company for $70 million. And the Tribune Company's newspaper division, which owns the Los Angeles Times, Chicago Tribune, and the Baltimore Sun, is also on the block. Donald Graham is chairman and CEO of the Washington Post Company. He joins me now. Full disclosure, I worked for you for the Washington Post.
I was going to ask if you were going to disclose your terrible conflict.
My terrible conflict for seven great years of the 1980s. Ruth Marcus, one of your leading columnists who sat at this table last Friday night with David Brooks, said that this is a brave and painful decision for your family to make. Was it also a necessary one?
Well, we thought so. The publisher of the Post now is Catherine Weymouth. That's a job that I held when you were on the paper, and I held it for 21 years. But Catherine and I sat down at the end of last year, the end of 2012, looked at how the paper had done in 2012 and what we could reasonably expect going forward. 2013 is the seventh consecutive year the paper's been down in revenues. So what do you do when you have less money coming in the door? You try to start new businesses, you try to innovate, and we've been pretty successful at that. But the decline, not successful enough that the total decline didn't.
A 44% decline.
Well, you're going back over several years there, but that's right. And mostly we have had to cut costs. The year of the financial crisis, 2009, was a very challenging year for us. Catherine and her team then brought the paper back to cash flow profitability the last 3 years. We certainly wanted to remain profitable. But around New Year's Day of this year, we started to ask ourselves for the first time whether it was possible that there was another owner who'd be better for the Post than our company had been.
When you say that, does that mean that there are things that you did or didn't do over the last several years you wish you had that you didn't have the vision to see?
Well, the one sentence that I think everybody in our building and everyone in this building would agree with, Gwen, is every year in the future, a few a higher percentage of people will read their news online or on mobile devices, just like the woman whose video clip you showed at the start of this segment, and slightly fewer people will read in print. The post-print circulation remains abnormally high for a Metro Daily. We're the number eight TV market in the country, but our paper is basically tied for first in circulation, print circulation, with the Los Angeles Times, which is in a much bigger market.
If you're,
But you know, we started to think to ourselves, for example, the technology sophistication of somebody like Jeff Bezos far surpasses mine. When I started on the paper when we were still using linotype machines and lead type, not altogether dissimilar from what Ben Franklin was doing in the 18th century. So Jeff's technology skills may be a little greater than mine.
So among your suitors, of which there were more than a few, Jeff Bezos was appealing to you because he's a digital native? Is that part of it?
Well, I've known Jeff Bezos for 15 years. He is and is known to be an extraordinarily decent man. I know him, and I've had the joy of getting to know his wife a bit. And it starts with that. He's principled. He's also a reader and a very good writer, as his statement to our staff, which has been widely quoted, reflects. He wrote that himself. He writes Amazon's annual shareholder letter by himself. He's known for being a very patient long-term investor, as he was with Amazon itself, as he was with the Kindle, and as he's been many other times. I don't want to appear to be speaking for Jeff, but he did speak for himself in his letter yesterday. He's not going to walk in the door with solutions, but he will walk in the door ready to try things. And Jeff, if you're Jeff Bezos or his peers, the founders or CEOs of great internet companies, you know a lot of great technologists.
And in fact, your publisher and your editorial page editor and your executive editor will stay in place for now.
Jeff's asked the whole management team to stay on, and that includes Catherine Weymouth, but it also includes Marty Baron, the editor of the Post, and Fred Hyatt, the editorial page editor, right, who's been on your program.
You know, I worked for four newspapers altogether over time, and I'm not the only one in the business and out of the business who wonder whether this isn't a turning point when a great family-owned newspaper hands itself over to someone who doesn't have anything to do with journalism, at least doesn't have any history in that.
Well, I hope it is. Jeff had fully as much to do with journalism in his previous career as Eugene Meyer, my grandfather, who bought the Post in 1933, having never worked a day on a newspaper and never having owned a business. But he had great mid-20th century skills. His skills were financial. He had been an investor, he'd made a lot of money on Wall Street, and then he'd been a senior government official. And because his ethics were pretty high, he'd stayed in government bonds during the Depression, so his ethics got him, not his investing skill, got him through. But he tried things. He tried to improve the paper, tried to make it better, tried to grow circulation, tried to grow advertising. Jeff, who is also a very skilled businessman, is going to come in. And as the word he used was experiment.
I heard you tell your staff that you've been in that building one way or the other, in some job or the other, for 42 years.
So I first was in the Washington Post building in January 1949 to see Harry Truman's inaugural parade when I was three.
Well, there you go. So tell me, what do you think this means, or what any of this means, not just you, but what's happening with Tribune, what's happening with these other papers? What does this mean for the future of newspapers as we've come to know them?
Well, I think, obviously, the Post is in a different position from other newspapers. We have a slightly different business than they do because we're in the nation's capital. We have an internet following that's pretty large relative to the size of Washington as a market because we're in the capital of the free world, and we try to report on what goes on here and what goes on around the world that's relevant to decisions in Washington. We're an independent newspaper. Our editorial page is not consistently down the line with either the Democratic or Republican parties. And our business is a little bit different. But I think what it means is that the Post is going to be an extraordinarily exciting place to be. You know, I can't imagine a news organization being a more exciting place in the immediate future.
What does it mean that we see so many print properties being sold to wealthy individuals rather than to multi-generational families?
Jeff is more than a wealthy individual. He is somebody who had an idea 15, 20 years ago, the crazy idea that he could successfully sell books on the internet. He's a reader and he's a writer. unusually out at Amazon. Meetings don't start with slide presentations or PowerPoints. By Jeff's request, they start with whoever convenes the meeting writing an essay. In the first 10 minutes, everybody sits down and reads what the person convening the meeting wrote. Why? Because he thinks writing requires thought. So that is a little tribute to the power of the written word. This is a very fine business executive. The post-great friend Warren Buffett has called Jeff the best CEO in America. And he's also extraordinarily thoughtful. But obviously, Gwen, for you and for me, we know a ton of our future is digital. And that's what Jeff brings.
Well, and I want you to put on your big thing hat and tell me whether you think there is a generational shift going not only among readers of the newspaper, but also owners of newspapers.
Well, I hope so. I'm 68 years old, so I'm not going to be, I'm going to be at the soon to be renamed Washington Post Company for for some time, I hope. But it's, by bringing somebody like Jeff Bezos in as the owner of the Washington Post, we're, I think, creating an opportunity for the readers of the Post, for those who work there. It could become, I think it will become, a very exciting place. We're going to keep doing what we've done. We've got the skills of the people in the building, plus the skills of Jeff Bezos.
Let me ask you a blunt question.
Want to know about your pension plan?
Not really. I want to ask you this: the question that one media analyst said that you lucked out in getting Jeff Bezos because it may save the paper. Is that what you're doing now? Are you saving the paper? Are you saving journalism?
No, I think the paper would have survived if we had not sold it. The paper would have survived fine under our ownership, under the current company. We would have had to keep cutting expenses as long as revenue fell. And our aspirations for the Post have always been way more than survival. We want to succeed. We want to expand. We want it to be a great place in a way that I think means something to you.
Don Graham, CEO of the soon-to-be-renamed Washington Post Company, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Gwen. Good being with you.